We have done in the last stanza that McClary gave sheet to Evans to write his detail in that. And after that, silence 9:20 a.m. McClary, I am now going to stop. He said, I am going to start the exam now. Evans, is he not going to stay here? Is he? And so Evans asked about Stephen. Is he going to stay here? McClary said, I don't know about that. He said, I don't know about that. Stephen said, Mr. Jackson's given me strict instructions to. He said, Mr. Jackson has given me instruction to be here. Evans says, how am I supposed to concentrate on my exam with someone breathing down my neck? Christ. Sorry, sir, I did not mean. Now he was saying, oh my God, how am I going to give the exam if somebody is sitting with me here breathing up and down. The governor reached for the phone. Jackson, good. Get Stephens out of the cell, will you? I think we are perhaps overdoing things. Then governor told Jackson, bring that Stephens out of the cell. We are overdoing the things now. It's enough, whatever security and things we have to keep in mind, it's okay. But now I think we are overdoing the things. Tell him to come out of the cell. As you wish, sir. The governor heard the exchange in the cell, heard that door clang once more, and heard McClary announce that the examination had begun at last. So governor heard about the talking and communication, whatever was going on, and the door also, the voice of the door. And the McClary said, I'm going to start the exam now. It was 9:25 a.m. and there was a great calm. At 9:40 a.m. the examination board rang through, and the assistant secretary with a special responsibility for modern languages asked to speak to the governor. So 9:40 a.m. again the bell rang of phone, and the secretary wanted to speak to governor. The examination had already started, no doubt. A quarter of an hour ago. He asked, hope examination is started. So governor said, yes, it is started. Yes, well, there was a correction slip which some fool had forgotten to place in the examination packet. Very brief. Could the governor please? He said, there is a correction slip that person has forgotten to put it there. Will you do the favor? Yes, of course. I'll put you straight to the through to Mr. Jackson in D wing. Hold the line a minute. He said, I'll ask Jackson to talk to you. Till then, you hold the line. Was it the sort of thing the governor had feared? Was the phone call fake? Some signals, some secret messages, but he could check on that immediately. He dialed the number of the examination board, but heard only the staccato beeps of a line engaged. So the governor was thinking, he was afraid of something that would be done by Evans, and something fake calls or something. Is it like that? Is it some signal for Evans to escape from the jail? So he wanted to check it immediately. He rang to examination board again, but it was coming staccato beeps, means when we dial the phone which is engaged, the long beeps come. So it was coming like that, but then the line was engaged, wasn't it? Yes, not very intelligent that. So he said, okay, line is engaged, it means the call would be from examination board only, so it's okay. 2 minutes later, he heard some whispered communication in the cell, and the McClary brought Scott's voice. And after 2 minutes, McClary was speaking in his Scottish voice. Will you please stop writing a while, Mr. Evans? He said, stop writing for a while and listen carefully. Candidates offering German 0211 should note the following correction on page 3, line 15. The fourth verse should read goldenen, not goldeny, and the whole phrase will therefore read zum goldenen. Lowen not zum goldenen lawn. I will repeat that. So this McClary said the fourth verse should be read like goldenen, not goldeny, and if the whole word phrase will be zum goldenen lawn, not zum goldeny lawn. I will repeat that. The governor listened and smiled. He had taken German in the sixth form himself, and he remembered all about the agreements of adjectives. So governor also was listening, and he was happy that, yes, because he also knew something about German, about the adjectives and all. And so did McClary, by the sound of things, for the minister's pronunciation was most impressive. But what about Evans? He probably did not know what an adjective was. They both knew about the adjective of German, but Evans did not know anything. The phone rang again. The magistrate's court. They needed a prison van and a couple of prison officers. Remand case, and within 2 minutes, the governor was wondering whether that could be a hoax. So again, one call came from magistrate's court, and they wanted a van with 2 prison officers. And governor was now again, he was thinking, maybe it's a hoax, maybe it's a fake call. He told himself not to be so silly. His imagination was beginning to run riot. He said, he thought maybe this can be fake, but now he was telling himself that don't be so silly. His imagination is going beyond now. He was thinking so much. Evans, for the first quarter of an hour, Stephens had dutifully peered through the peephole at intervals of 1 minute or so. So Stephens was in duty there near the door. He was peeping inside the hole after the intervals of 1 or 2 minutes. And after that, every 2 minutes, at 10:45 a.m., everything was still all right as he looked through the peephole once more. 10:45, he looked again, everything was okay. It took 4 or 5 seconds, no more. What was the point? It was always more or less the same, Evans. His pen between his lips sat staring straight in front of him towards the door. And Evans was sitting like this continuously, keeping his pen on his lips and towards the door, seeking, it seemed, some sorely needed inspiration from somewhere. It was looking like what happens when we give the exam and we don't know any question. We think like something, some inspiration, something from somebody will help us. And opposite him, McClary, seated slightly askew from the table now. His face is semi-profile. He was sitting slightly askew, means slightly slanting. He was sitting and his face could be seen half-face for one side. His hair, as Stephens had noticed earlier, amateurishly clipped pretty close to the scalp. Amateur means not done perfectly. Okay, unprofessionally we can say. His eyes behind the pebble lens peering short-sightedly at the church times, and with the spectacles he was reading church times. His right index finger hooked beneath the narrow clerical collar. Right hand index finger, it was in the collar. And the fingers of the left hand, the nails meticulously manicured. And in the left hand finger, it could be seen that his nails are meticulously, means very carefully manicured. Slowly stroking the short black beard, and he was stroking his beard. At 10:50 a.m., the receiver crackled to life, and the governor realized he had almost forgotten Evans for a few minutes. So 10:50, again the bell rang, and he forgot about Evans for a few minutes. Evans, please, sir, a whisper. Please, sir, would you mind if I put a blanket round me? Shoulder, sir. It's a bit parky in here, isn't it, silent? So Evans was asking Mr. McClary, can he have the blanket because it is cold here. There is one on me bunk here, sir. Be quick about it. He said, there is one blanket in my bunk. Can I have it, sir? So sir said, okay, but be quick. So Evans asked McClary to have blanket because he was feeling cold there while giving exam. At 10:51 a.m., Stephens was more than a little surprised to see a grey regulation blanket draped round Evans' shoulder. So Stephen came to see again what was going on in the cell. It was 10:51 a.m. So he saw that Evans had wrapped the blanket around him. And he frowned slightly and looked at the examinee more closely. So he frowned from there and he looked at them closely, what is going on there. But Evans, the pen still between his teeth, was staring just as vacantly as before, blankly beneath a blanket. But still he was sitting in the same posture and he had his pen between his teeth and he was just staring just as vacantly, blankly. And he was inside the blanket. So the Stephens report the sight irregularity? Anything at all fishy? Helen Jackson said. He looked through the peephole once again, and even as he did so, Evans pulled the dirty blanket more closely to himself. Now he was thinking, should he report about this all, or it is just anything at all fishy? Is it doubtful or something like that he has to tell to Jackson now? He looked through the peephole again. And when he was looking inside, Evans again pulled the dirty blanket more closely to him. He must be feeling cold. Was he planning a sudden Batman leap to suffocate McClary in the blanket? Don't be daft. There was never any sun on this side of the prison. no heating either during the summer months, and it could get quite chilly in some of the cells. So he was saying that maybe he is planning to suffocate McCleary and kill him there and escape from the jail. Then he told him himself only, don't be crazy, because this place, there was never some, it's never sunny in this place, in the prison, or no heat also this side. So maybe it will be cold in some of the cells. Stephen decided to revert to his earlier every minute observation. Now he thought of going back from this observation. At 11:20 a.m., the receiver once more crackled across the silence of the governor's office. Again, the bell rang, and McCleary informed Ivan that only 5 minutes remained. The examination was almost over now, so it was going to be over now. But something still gnawed away quietly in the governor's mind. But still something was, G is silent here, G-N-A-W-E-D, gnawed. Still something was hitting in governor's mind. He reached for the phone once more. At 11:22 a.m., Jackson shouted along the corridor to Stephen. The governor wanted to speak with him. So Jackson again shouted at 11:22 a.m. that the governor wants to talk to him. Hurry, man. Stephen picked up the phone apprehensively and listened to the rapidly spoken order. And very fearfully he listened to the, picked up the phone and listened to the order. Stephens himself was to accompany McCleary to the main prison gates. So he has to go with McCleary to prison gate to see him off. Understood. Stephen personally was to make absolutely sure that the door was locked on Evans after McCleary had left the cell. Understood. So these all the instructions were given to Stephens. You will go with McCleary till prison gate, and you will make sure that when McCleary will go, all the doors should be closed where Evans is there. At 11:25 a.m., the governor heard the final exchange. Now, final, they were discussing. McCleary, stop writing, please. Silence. Put your sheets in order and see they are correctly numbered. Silence. Scrapping of chairs and tables. So this was the last, the exam was over. He told him to put his sheets properly in the order. And thank you very much, sir. All right, was it? Not too bad. So he was asking, McCleary was asking, hope your paper was right. He said, not too bad. Good, Mr. Stephens. The governor heard the door clang for the last time. The examination was over. Governor was hearing this, listening to these, all the conversation in his microphone, in the phone. So he was listening to this, then the door clanged. Examination was over. How did he get on, do you think? Asked Stephens as he walked beside McCleary to the main gates. Now, they both were going, McCleary and Stephen, to the gate. So he asked, how did he do in exam? Oh, I cannot think he has distinguished himself. So he said, I don't think he has done very good himself in the exam. I'm afraid. He said, I do not think he has done very good. I'm afraid. His scout's accent seemed broader than ever, and his long black overcoat reaching almost to his knees. So the Stephen says, when he was taking him back, McCleary back, this Scottish accent in which he was speaking, it looked a little bit different from there. And his overcoat also reaching almost to his knees, fostered the illusion that he had suddenly grown slimmer. And Stephen was thinking how it happened that it is like an illusion or something confusing that he has grown slim now. Slimmer than before. Stephens felt pleased that the governor had asked him and not Jackson. But Stephen was feeling good that governor had asked him to leave McCleary to the gate to see McCleary off the premises. So he was feeling happy that governor had asked Stephen, not Jackson, to see him off the premises of this jail. And all in all, the morning had gone pretty well. But something stopped him from making his way directly to the canteen for a belated cup of coffee. He said morning was good, but one thing was there which he missed. It was his cup of coffee. He wanted to take just one last look at Evans. It was like a program he had seen on TV about a woman who could never really convince herself that she had locked the front door when she had gone to bed. So he was again, before going from there, he was again looking at Evans. And he was thinking of one TV show in which he has seen that the woman, she will not be convinced about her locked before going to bed. So many times she will go and check it. Often she had got up 12, 15, sometimes 20 times to check the board. Sometimes it happens with us also when we are confused. We think that, oh, we have closed the door or not, we have switch off the lights or not, something, and we check it again and again. So he said, I was also checking like that. He re-entered D wing, made his way along Ivan's cell and opened the peephole once more. He again came there and he checked again. Oh no, Christ, no. There sprawled back in Ivan's chair was a man. For a semi-second, Stephen thought it must be Ivan. So when he came back, he said, oh my God, there was one person lying there in the in which chair the, this Ivan was sitting. And Stephen was thinking it is it must be Ivan. A grey regulation blanket slipping from his shoulder. And that same blanket was slipping down from the shoulder. The front of his closely cropped irregularly tufted hair awash with fierce red blood which had dripped already through the small black beard. And this his hair, they were coming on his face, the long hair, they were of red color now, and the blood was also dripping from his beard and was even now spreading horribly over the white clerical collar and down into the black clerical front. So when he saw that man, he was lying on the chair in which Ivan was sitting, and in his hair, they have become red color because of blood, and blood was even dripping down, and in his beard also, and even now spreading to his white collar and down to the black clerical front. So it means when he saw there that one person was lying on the chair, he thought it would be Ivan's, and he was filled with blood, and it was blood were dripping down into his collar and to his neck.